come into this house.
Start to see him.
will start to hear him. We will get to know him more deeply. And we will want to follow him more boldly. As I welcome each and every one of you here today, this afternoon, I invite you all to seek his face, and I'm convinced that your life will change for the better. With these words of church, I welcome you all, and may the Lord bless you. Oh, the opening hymn. We all can stand up to say the opening hymn in 526.
Thank you. found in the book of Psalm. We're going to read Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord and everything in it, the world and all who live in it, for he founded it on the seas and established it on the waters. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or swear by false god. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God the Savior. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, your gates. He lifted up your ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, your gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty, he is the King of glory. Amen. The word of God.
Amen.
We're going to kneel down for prayer. Wash us in your blood, O Lord. We need you in our life. Come and dwell in us by your Holy Spirit. Lord, at this present time, bless your church. Bless the young people. Bless each one and everyone in here today. We are living in the end of time. We will not do us to open up our minds, our understanding, and help us to understand our surroundings. Help us to understand what's going on in the world right now. And help us to spend time with you in your word so that we may know you better. We would like to ask you to intervene for us, Lord. Bless your church throughout the world, especially here. Bless Shiloh. Oh Lord, we need your presence. We need your Holy Spirit. Help us to keep our eyes on you and on you only. Lord, bless your servant, Pastor David Kevin, who's going to preach your word. May your Holy Spirit be with him so that your words can go straight to our hearts and prepare our hearts to receive what you have for us today. Bless the service for us. Thank you for your presence. We ask that in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
This time we're going to have the question, and we're asking that the church send us so that we can place together.
Happy Sabbath, church. If you survived the snow today, say amen.
Amen.
Come on, we can't be too grumpy. God has been good. He's preserved this part of town from our usual amount of snowfall, so we can't let a couple of inches just break our spirits. We're grateful for the gift of life. We're grateful for mercy and favor that allows us to worship our great God today. So the song we're just going to sing, we're just going to ask you to just lift up your voices, sing with us. You're familiar with them, and we're just going to do our best to praise the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. The song says, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so natural in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us.
Oh.
We give you all the glory today.
I believe Shiloh, when we were young, only closed down one time because of snow. Other than that, snow, we came to church. Church probably didn't start on time, but we came to church because where else are you gonna go on Saturday? We come to worship God, but you guys are acting like you're not happy to be here. You're dead for whatever reason. I don't know why, but we're gonna try to change all of that. So let's all get up. Unless we didn't greet each other, so let's all get up and let's give 5 people hugs and let them know we're happy to see them today. Come on, not the people next to you, get up, cross the other side, tell them you're happy to see them today. All right, let's try that again. Happy Sabbath, church. See that? See that? Now the blood is flowing and we're in the house of God. That's good, that's good. And I don't even think, is outside that bad? I mean, if it was a matter of work, we would all made it to work. But let us always remember to put God first. Look at your neighbor and say, put God first. We need to put God first. To begin, you don't have to open your Bible. I'm going to ask if they could put on the screen Exodus chapter 3, verse 8. Exodus chapter 3, verse 8. That's going to be on the screen for us. But for you guys, pull out your Bibles or your cell phones, and we're going to read for ourselves Numbers chapter 13. Numbers chapter 13. Numbers chapter 13, and we will start with verse 26. Numbers chapter 13. And are you there? You gotta have your Bibles or your cell phones open. Open up the Bible app for Numbers chapter 13, and we'll start with verse 26. I'm reading from the New King James Version, but did we get this up here? All right, let me see. That's exactly the verse we wanted. All right. Before we get into the Word of God, let us say a quick word of prayer. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. Heavenly Father, we dare not read your Word without the guidance of your Holy Spirit. Sanctify us with thy truth, for thy Word is truth. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. All right. So, we're going to read, just hold your Bibles open, but we're going to read Exodus 3 verse 8, which is already on the screen. You don't have to turn to it. It's right there on the screen, and I'm going to ask if we could read it together. And please, let's all read together on the count of three. One, two, three. And I... Come on, I don't even hear this side. Come on, folks. One, two, three. And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land unto a good land, and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. All right? All right, all the sites. God's gonna give them all sites. So I need us to understand what we're reading here. This verse is gonna be here throughout the rest of this afternoon as we're going through the message. But who is talking right now? We're reading in Exodus. God. God is talking, all right? You gotta be on the same page here. Look to your neighbor and say, God is talking right now. All right, so God is talking. And this is, if you're not familiar with the story, this is when God frees the people of Israel from the Egyptian bondage. And God is talking to Moses. And what does God tell Moses? What does he promise Moses? What land does God promise Moses for Israel? Canaan. You see, it says it right there. Flowing with milk and honey unto the place of the Canaanites. So God promises Israel the land of Canaan. It's not what Pastor Kamen is saying. It's what God is saying. You guys see that right there? It says unto the place of the Canaanites. And then he doesn't only specify the Canaanites. He gives details. He says the Hittites, the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites, all the sites, all right? So, God promises Israel Canaan, all right? Say that. God promises Israel Canaan. All right? You got to understand this. What I want you to understand is, when God gives us a promise, it's going to happen. You got to understand that. He never gives details, but when he says something, it's going to happen. The only thing, though, is that when God gives a promise, it doesn't happen on its own. Do you guys understand this? If God says that this is mine, right here, this is mine, and I'm standing right here, he promised me that that's mine. But what do I have to do to get the promise? Okay, I could claim it. I claim that what God said is mine, but I'm right here. So what do I have to do to get to the promise? So that tells me when God gives us a promise, there's something we have to do. God promised me this, but he didn't. God's not going to make the Bible come to me. If God promises me something, I have to believe the promise of God and go to what he promised me and take it because God promised it for me. You guys understand that? This is the promise that God gave to Moses for Israel. This is not complicated. There's no tricks about this. There's no, you know, when you buy something, they have tiny print or whatever for them to take it back. But here, God is saying, listen, I promised you something. It's yours. I'm going to give it to you. And that's it. There's no questions asked. The only thing is you have to go and get it. All right? Now, we're in Numbers chapter 13. Let me give you the background before we read this. Moses, the people of Israel are free from Egypt. Moses is leading the people with his brother Aaron, and they're leading the people to the promised land. And they get to the promised land, and God tells Moses, well, for the Bible scholars, how many tribes were there in the people people of Israel? 12 tribes. So God tells Moses, get one man from each tribe and send them to the land of Canaan as spies. For the mathematicians, if Moses has to get one man from each tribe, and there's 12 tribes, how many spies is that going to equal? 40? Are we quiet still? It's not complicated, folks. Hear me out. How many tribes are there? All right, there's 12 tribes. And God tells Moses, take one man from each tribe and make them go spy in the land of Canaan. How many spies did Moses send to Canaan? All right, there you go. It's not complicated, guys. Amen. So he sent 12 spies into the land of Canaan. They come back after 40 days. How many days did they spend in the land of Canaan? They come back after 40 days, and they come with a report of what they saw in the land of Canaan after 40 days. And this is what we're going to read now in Numbers chapter 13, starting with verse 26. Verse 26 says this. No, I want to keep that promise there, so I'm going to ask somebody. Can somebody read verse 26? Numbers 13, verse 26, please.
And they went and came to Moses and to Aaron and to all the congregation of the children of Israel unto the wilderness of Paran to Kadesh and brought back word unto them and unto all the congregation and showed them the fruit of the land.
Sorry. You're going to be my Bible reader today. Is that all right?
That's cool.
All right. You don't have to stand. You can read. Can you read that again, please?
Okay.
He's reading verse, Numbers 13, verse 26. Follow along with them.
And they went and came to Moses and to Aaron and to all the congregation of the children of Israel unto the wilderness of Paran to Kadesh and brought back word unto them and unto all the congregation and showed them the fruit of the land.
Okay, how many spies went to Canaan? How long did they stay out there? 40 days. Now, after 40 days, all 12 of them came back, and based upon the verse we just read, what did they bring back? They brought back fruit, and what else did they bring back? They brought back a word. They brought back fruit, and they brought back a word. Okay, you gotta understand this. I want you to understand this. They brought back fruit. Everybody say fruit. And they also brought back a word. Say a word. All right. Now, verse 27. What do they say? Can you read that? Verse 27 now. Then they told, now they come back in verse 26. I'm sorry, verse 26 says, they're speaking, all 12 spies are speaking to Moses, to Aaron, and all the people of Israel. Now remember, the reason why he sent 12 spies into the land of Canaan is because God promised it to them. You have to remember this. They didn't go on their own will or whatever. The reason why they went to Canaan is because God promised it to them. So they just went to go see what God promised them. So after 40 days, after they explored the promise that God gave them, they came back to report to the people what the promise, what they saw about what God promised them. Now, verse 27 says what?
And they told him and said, we came unto the land whither thou sentest us, and surely it floweth with milk and honey.
Okay. What did they just say? Milk and honey. Why would they say, it said it's true. Why do they need to say that it's true that the land that we went to go examine is flowing with milk and honey? Because God promised it. You see right there? Where it says, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, they hadn't been to Canaan yet. Before they came to Canaan, they only had the promise of God. And so now that they actually come to the actual land, they go and verify if the promise that God gave them was actually true. And so they come back and they tell all the people, listen, the promise that God gave us, it's true. You gotta understand something. People lie, but God never lies. When God promises you something, know it's going to be true. Don't ever question God, don't doubt God. Just if God says it, then the Bible says God is not a man that he should lie. When God speaks, it's going to happen. It may not happen at that time, but it's going to happen. Hence why the word says that God's word never returns void. That means if something comes out of God's mouth, it'll never come back to him until it actually happens. And so this promise that we read in Exodus 3 verse 8, the spies actually come back and say, listen, the God that saved us from Egypt and caused us to cross the Red Sea, who brought us to the land of Canaan, what he actually said is true. And then they showed the people the fruit. How many people like raisins? Nobody likes raisins? Red raisins, green raisins, black raisins, grapes? Okay, grapes. How many people like grapes? So let me tell you, they went to the land of Canaan and they brought back fruit. Ellen White says they brought back vines of grapes. The grapes were so big that it needed two men to carry them. Have you ever seen grapes that big? That's how big the grapes were in the land of Canaan. That two men had to carry a vine of grapes, and they brought that as proof that, listen, the land that God promised us, not only is it flowing with milk and honey, but it has enough food to sustain us. See, you missed that. Let me help you understand that. When God promises us something, not only does he give us a promise, but if you believe in that promise will be able to sustain you and keep you no matter what you're going through in your life. God doesn't just say something just to say it. He says it so that you can have life in its fullness. So now we get to this now, and it says, verse 28, can you read that for me out loud again?
Nevertheless, the people be strong that dwell in the land, and the cities are walled and very great. And moreover, we saw the children of Anak there.
What's the most important word in that verse that he just read there? Nope, not the children of Anak. Nevertheless, your Bible might say, but. or therefore, or in spite of. But here's what I need you to understand as God's people. When God gives us a promise, there's always going to be a but from the devil. You got to understand this. God always gives us the promise and that's it. He never tells us the circumstances or how it's going to happen or when it's going to happen. He just says, listen, I promise you a land flowing with milk and honey. He doesn't say how he's going to remove the Canaanites or the Hittites or the Amorites or the Perizzites. He lets you know that those people are there, but even though those people are there, that's not his concern. The promise is the land is yours. But, turn to your neighbor and say, but. Don't you hate it when you're talking to somebody and then you ask them, let's say you ask them, you ask me for $100. And I say, yes. You get excited, right? But then if my next word is but, then you stop for a second. And the $100, I said, yes, you can have the $100, but there's a but. So here now though, here now you hear the but and you begin to question. And here the 12 spies come back and they say, yes, the promise of God is true, but. And the but that they're saying, God already told them about it. So it shouldn't be anything new. It shouldn't make us afraid or scared. The only thing we should hold on to is the promise of God. Now, verse, they say the but, and then they're going to go down to verse 30. And even though they hear the but, here's what Caleb says, a young kid.
And Caleb stilled the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it.
Now, the problem is this. Caleb is a young person. Caleb he's probably a teenager at this time. And the older people are the ones who, they went with the young people. So you had old and young people go for 40 days and look through the land of Canaan. They come back with a report. They have a word and they have fruit. They show them the fruit and then they give them the word. They say, yes, the promise of God is true, but there's Amalekites in the land. And Caleb stands up, a young person, and says, don't worry about that. If God be for us, who can be against us? And you would think, what's supposed to happen when somebody quotes scripture? Oh, I guess you don't know. So let me tell you. When you hear scripture, you know, we get so excited when we're hearing sermons and the pastor, whoever's preaching, they say something real cool and they use words and we start saying amen or whatever the case may be. But biblically speaking, when we say amen, amen is confirming the word of God. So when we're supposed to say amen when we hear the word of God. So let me help you understand. There's a scripture that says, if God be for us, who could be against us? And your response is? All right. There's another scripture that says, greater is he that is in us than him that is in the world. Your response is supposed to be? Because when you're saying amen, you're saying, I agree with what the word of God says. So Caleb now, he comes, he says, let us go at once and take possession, for we are all well able to overcome it. The reason why Caleb says this is because he's standing on the promise that God gave him. And the people should have said what? Amen. Come on, you gotta work with me here. The people should have said what? Amen. But they don't. They don't. Here's what the people say, and this is verse 31.
But the men that went up with him said, we be not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we.
So the response in Numbers 13, verse 31 said, after Caleb said, we can do it. Well, God said we can do it, so let's come together and do it. The next verse is very clear. It says, but the men. And here's what we need to understand as a church. Sometimes, not all the time, we have young people who are on fire for God. They want to do something that has never been done before. And what's causing them to want to do it is because they're claiming the promise of God. But then there's some older people who say, well, no, no, no. That's not how we do things. Before we do it, we need to have a meeting. We need to fast and pray. And we need to ask God for guidance. This is what always blows my mind. How is it? Like, you know, during election, nominations. During nominations, the church votes for a committee. And that committee goes in the back room or during the week. And they pray. And after they pray, they come together and they start choosing names for specific departments. And then they call, I'm gonna pick on Brother Vic. They call Brother Vic and they say, Brother Vic, the nominating committee has nominated you to be an elder. What blows my mind is that Brother Elder Vic now would turn around and say, let me pray about it. That doesn't make sense to me. Because before they told him, what did they do? They prayed. They asked God. God gave them Brother Vic's name. So now the committee calls Elder Vic and says, we want to nominate you as an elder. His response is, let me pray about it. Now, my question is, what does he possibly think the answer is going to be when he asked God? Could God, after Vic goes and prays and says, God, you know, the committee said that they prayed and you gave them my name. I just want to know if it's true. Is God going to now turn around and say, oh, that was my mistake. When they were praying, I was busy and you were on my mind and your name just came out of my... No, that's not going to happen. Because when God says something, we should follow it, even if it doesn't make sense to us. Young people, and I'm talking to us as adults. Adults, we need to understand, our young people, there are things that they want to do that we may not be accustomed to doing it, but we should support them because they're doing it for the will of God. We need to support our young people and encourage them to do the work of God, even if it's different from how we would have done it when we were younger. And so here in verse 31, men stand up and they say, we are not able to go against the people, for they are stronger than we. Here's what I want you to understand. God gave them a promise. Caleb and Joshua doesn't show up, but there were two people out of the 12. There were two who were like, we can do it because God said so. Ten men stood up and said, no, we can't do it. And do you know, because of what the 10 men did, the whole nation had to turn around and walk around the promise that God had given them. And do you realize that they missed the promise because of 16 words? Turn to your neighbor and say 16 words. 16 words destroy a whole nation. 16 words, and the words are simply, we are not able to go up against people, for they are stronger than we. Those 16 words, let me tell you where those 16 words came from. God gave them a promise, and what they were afraid of, and here's what you need to understand. They had evidence right next to them. The evidence was the grapes And they saw milk and honey. They had the evidence and they had a word. The word was simply, it is true. What the promise that God gave us, the land is flowing with milk and honey. That's the word. And they had fruit. And the fruit was right there. And the fruit was so big that two men had to carry it. And even though they had those two witnesses, they still walked away from the promise of God, all because of negativity. And what I want us to understand today is negativity can destroy a Christian's life. We must learn to stop being negative and start believing in the promises of God. With everything that's going on outside, the one place we should be able to come and hear positive things is in the church of God. We should be encouraging one another. We should be lifting up each other through the word of God. Because without this, we'll miss out on our promise. Here's what I want you to understand. Because of the negativity, they were afraid of what they didn't even see yet. The ten men said, oh, there's big Amalekites here. They're so big that they make us look like grasshoppers. The people, once they heard what the 10 men said, they didn't even go into the land to look for themselves. They just said, you know what? Because that's what they said, I'm turning my back. And how many of us, as God's children, have turned our backs on the promise that God has given us all because of what somebody else said? I want you to know today that we need to stop listening to what people say and start focusing on what the Word of God says. People will not always agree with what the Word of God says. But if you spend time in the Word of God, no matter what people may say, you need to put your faith in the Word of God. Let me bring it home to help you understand. Never let people use words to kick you out of the church of God. Too many times I've heard people say, I left church because somebody said such and such. What they say should never be the determining factor of you leaving the house of God. But instead, it's what God says that should determine if whether or not you're going to be in the house of God. And God says that he died for all of us. And that he's coming back for all of us. So because that's what God says, we should never leave the presence of God. Because of what people say, we become afraid of what we don't know. God gave them the promise. The people hadn't gone into the land of Canaan. And they refused to go because of what somebody said. And what did those people say? They said, man, the men on that land, they're so big, they make us look like grasshoppers. And so those people now, they hadn't seen them, but because that's what they heard, they allowed what they heard to dictate how they're going to live. Do we let somebody say something negative to us, and that causes us to miss out on what God has in store for us? Let me give you an example. You don't know, you're in a situation right now in your life, and you don't know how you're going to get, you don't know how, let me give you an example. You have bills to pay. The bills are due next week. You don't know where you're going to get the money from. And somebody comes and says, listen, you're not going to have that money by next week, so you need to go and kill yourself. Are you going to let what that one person say, now say, you know what, you're right, I'm not going to have that money. So you go to the tallest building and you jump? You would get scared at night. Instead, you would ignore what that person say, and you would do everything within your power before next week came to find the money that you needed to pay those bills, correct? Why is it it that we don't take that same mentality in our Christian lives? God promised us peace, love, and a sound mind. Why are we letting people stress us out? Why are we letting how people look at us, what people say about us, affect our Christian walk? I want to challenge us today to not listen to what people say anymore, but start listening to what the Word of God says. I want to challenge us today to spend time in the morning. The first thing you do every day is just listen to what God has to say about you. So that when you go throughout the day, the devil's going to talk negativity to you. He's going to say bad things about you. But regardless of what you hear during the day, you need to remember the promises of God that he told you in the morning. This is why this is so important, to remember the promise that God gives us. Because when he gives you a promise, that's what gives you strength to get through the day. That's all that gives you strength. Let me wrap this up so I can help you understand. You see this snow outside today? How many of us woke up, looked outside the window, said, "Oh, I'm not going to church today"? Be honest. And we looked outside and we saw, I was like, "Man, the snow is high." And it was probably still snowing. And we're like, "Man, it might snow all day." And we looked at the phone, because we all have the weather app, and the weather app said it was going to stop snowing by 9 o'clock. But we didn't believe it, because in our mind, we wanted to believe it was going to snow all day, so we wouldn't have to go to church. That's our mentality for church. But now, imagine if this same weather happened during the week, our work week. We would wake up, look outside the window, be like, "Man, I gotta hurry up and get to work." We wouldn't go back to bed. We would try to figure out, we would actually look at the clock and be like, "Okay, I gotta time it right. I gotta go clean up my car. I gotta shower, bathe, get dressed, and I gotta worry about traffic." And we would get to work. We might be a little bit late to work. We'll call in advance because we're gonna be late, but we'll make sure we get to work. The reason is because with work, we know that if we go to that, we're going to get something every 2 weeks. It's called a paycheck. Turn to your neighbor and say, "A paycheck." So we know that in spite of the storm, we're going to go in that storm because we know in the end, we're going to get a reward. Do you guys understand that? We call it a paycheck. Turn to your neighbor and say, "A paycheck." You got to understand that. I want to say that to you one more time. We understand about our jobs that when we wake up and we see a storm outside, we're willing to go through that storm because we know at the end we're going to get something called a paycheck. Why is it we don't have that same mentality when it comes to worshiping God? How is it that you don't know that in spite of the storm, it may not be easy right now, but soon and very soon, we are all going to see King Jesus? That is what should drive us. That is what should motivate us. That no matter what we're going through, in the end, Jesus Christ will be King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We need to have that mentality in our lives and understand that as long as we fight for Jesus, God will always fight our battles. As long as we hold on to the Word of God, we will never have anything to fear. Because if God be for us, who can be against us? Oh, yeah, I got it. Okay. No weapon formed against us shall prosper. All right. See, you guys, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Say it with me. That whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Yes. There you go. You see how in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth? Yes. Oh man, see, you gotta hold on to the Word. You have to hold on to the Word. And it's the Word that's going to bring you through. It's the word that's going to sustain you. It's the word that's going to remind you that it's the promise of God that's what gives us strength. Don't let what people say about you discourage you. There's a song that says, you can talk about me as much as you please. I'll talk about you down on my knees. Let people say what they want to say about you, but fall on your knees and let God remind you who you are. If you believe and you understand the word of God, I want us to sing a song to close. It's called Wonderful Words of Life. Have you guys ever sang that before? All right, let us stand. It says, sing them over again to me, wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see, wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty, teach me faith and duty. Beautiful words, wonderful words of life. Let us all stand and sing this song. It's number 286 in our handbooks, or if you have it on your phone. You don't even have to go up there. Just stay right here. Oh, she's getting a handbook? All right. Is it on the screen? All right. Are you guys familiar with this?
Yeah.
Sing along as we go. 1, 2, 3. Sing them over again to me, wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see, wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty, teach me faith and duty. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Christ the Blessed One. Christ the Blessed One gives to all wonderful words of life. Sinnerless to the loving call, wonderful words of life. All so freely given, wooing us to heaven. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words.
Sweetly echo the gospel call.
Sweetly echo the gospel call. Wonderful words of life. Offer pardon and peace to all. Wonderful words of life. Jesus only Savior, sanctified forever. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life.
Well, and it's kind of different today. Let's grab a partner, stand, and just hold hands and just pray for each other. And ask that you hold on to the promises of God. Turn to your neighbor and just start pray with each other, and then I'll close for a final prayer. You're praying to hold on to the promise and not listen to what the world says about you. You are a child of God. Encourage one another. Pray for each other. Come on. You're praying for each other. You're praying for each other.
Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for sending Jesus Christ to die on the cross, not for his sins, but for our sins. We want to thank you for the promise that you've given us, that soon and very soon we will all see the King. Until then, Father, may we not forget about this promise. May we read this promise in the morning, read this promise during the afternoon, and read the promise before we go to bed. Fill us with your Holy Spirit, Father. Strengthen us and keep us whole. In Jesus' name we do pray.
He has made me glad. I will rejoice.